holding on to your mobile for a very long period of time, probably even after 100th apple, Newton wouldn't have discovered the Newton's law. So it's better you need to have an idea about what you're going to do it. To start with a simple example of how we have done research, even with the simple cases like that. We all know that intertrochanteric fractures are the most commonest fractures that are available in our clinical practice. In fact, it is being said that it is a bread and butter for any orthopedician. To start with this kind of fractures, which are automatically commonly seen, in fact, every orthopedician will see some 4 to 5 cases in a month. So what we do is that we wanted to do something related to the treatment of intertrochanteric fractures. And so when I did inside, what I found that the treatment is either by the DHS or a PFLN. And over a period of time, I realized that even IT fracture, the treatment has become gold standard with the help of PFLN, even in stable as well as unstable fractures. So how do I do research in this kind of scenario, which everyone tries to ask? Then I started digging and reading about understanding the basics. Then I happened to find out the basic mechanics of these two devices. One is a load sharing device and the other one is a load bearing devices. And there is a contrasting difference between the treatment in these two. After some time, after reading and clinically practicing for some more years and some more cases down the line, what is already found that there are certain outliers. Means a single fracture has been treated by multiple methods. And everyone has discovered all the methods, what I can do it from simple osteosynthesis to total replacement. And even I thought that, okay, let me do a comparative study and did a literature search. And they found that there are so many papers comparing one treatment to other, and even they have published a meta-analysis. Then the question arises, what we can do it? If you look at an X-ray like this, probably it appears to be a simple, straightforward X-ray fracture. And then you end up doing this fracture with an intramedullary device like this. And then post-operatively, what I found that, yes, there is a screw which is coming out through the fracture site. In fact, the proximal fragment has shifted more laterally, medial fragment a bit medial side, and the distal fragment more medial side. There is some amount of varus collapse. What to do with that? And then I saw some more X-rays where I found that the central screw is going through the fracture site, and then there is a small amount of flexion of the proximal fragment. How to go about it? Then I went back to the literature, and then they found that there is a new classification for intertrochanteric fractures based on the integrity of the lateral femoral valve. And this is what my X-ray and this fracture pattern fits into it. What can I do about it? Thinking about it, and connecting all the key points that I have about intertrochanteric fractures, what I realized is that there is a peritrochanteric fracture. It's a reverse oblique type of fracture. Medial comminution is there as well. I want to prevent varus collapse postoperatively. And at the same time, I want to be minimally invasive and cost effective, because they say that when there is no lateral cortex, you have to buttress it with a perilock plate. In fact, the implant is very much costlier. Being a nailer from the beginning, I don't want to do a large plate to be placed on the lateral cortex, lateral wall, and then end up in stripping a lot of soft tissue. So this is how, is there any possibility by which I can combine these two techniques, an intramedullary and a plate devices? That is when, for this kind of fracture, we introduce this concept. This concept where there is an intramedullary device as well, and to prevent the proximal fragment to go into varus, we buttressed it with the plate on the lateral cortex. So I want it to be much more flexible. I don't want to stick on to only a specific kind of fracture to be treated with that. So I wanted to see what else I can do with my new technique. Then I realized that if you look at this kind of fracture, any experienced surgeon would tell that the best answer for this kind of fractures is that you do a replacement, like you use a calcar replacing stem. Along with that, you need to reconstruct the greater trochanter with an SS wire or something like that. Can I do something with the intramedullary device as well? So then what happened? We did an extension of our study into much more different kind of case scenarios like this. For example, we extended the plate more proximally, we reconstructed the abductor mechanisms, pulled out and sutured onto a proximal hole present in the plate. So what we did was that we did a reconstruction similar to that what we do in proximal humerus fractures by reconstructing the rotator cuff during the course of time. So we are able to get results. So again, coming back to the original idea, there is an intertrochanteric fractures. What are the basics that we know? There are standard and new fracture patterns as well. And there are more than multiple treatment options present for the same fracture. We want to combine more than one method. At the same time, you should be cost effective. So then came the concept of nail with plate. So this is how we proposed a thesis called treatment and prevention of varus collapse of a reverse oblique type of intertrochanteric fractures with intramedullary nail and a buttress knit plate fixation, a novel technique. This is how, if you happen to see your clinical cases on a day-to-day basis, probably you may find some small minute points, and based on it, you'll be able to do clinical research even with a minimal number of cases as well. Thank you very much, sir. This is about my first talk, sir. It's a continuation of it. I'll be doing one more talk. So now what has happened is that now after listening to this talk, everyone will be excited to do a research. And then when you start doing your clinical research or do some studies, you should know what is the strength of your study. To know the strength of your study, you should know that what is the, because whenever you start reading a lot of journals, there'll be a lot of rubbish. In fact, there are so many number of articles that is there. You need to identify what is good, what is bad, and what is really required for your clinical practice. So came the question of levels of evidence. I'd like to again give in detail, or probably in terms of examples, how the levels of evidence can play around in your clinical practice. For example, something like this. There is Preeti Health Times, which is a monthly magazine, which has been published by our hospital. One day, one of the editor asked me to write a...
Sir, you cannot see clearly your slide. Maybe you should stop sharing and again share your...
Okay, sir, I'll do it once again, sir.
Yeah. You just stop once and then share again.
Okay, sir. Shall I do it once again, sir?
Yeah, please. Okay,
sir. Am I visible now, sir?
Yeah, please.
So now I'd like to give an example how we have evolved over a period of time in terms of doing levels of evidence. Like I told earlier, they asked me to write an article about osteoarthritis. What I did was that I read everything about osteoarthritis and also what we are practicing at our hospital. So I wrote an article about osteoarthritis, and then again, okay, it's degenerative changes occur in the joint, and then it can be treated either by braces or by surgery. So what is that article is called? It's just in my expert opinion or an editorial of the about a condition, that's all. The strength of this expert opinion is very least, and this stays in the base of the levels of evidence. Then after some time, what we did was that there was an young patient with stiffness of the elbow. So what he was advised elbow arthroplasty by some other surgeon, he came to us saying that you please do surgery. In fact, we were very reluctant to do it. And then what we did was we did interpositional arthroplasty for this. And then there were only two cases down the line, but the results were very much encouraging. So we published this data. So then this becomes a simple case report or a case series. So this is how a case report can also be published if you get very good results in your clinical practice. This is how the case series or case reports, which stays one step above the editorials. Then gradually, when the number of cases did increase over a period of time, what we did was we choose the same patient. In one of the knee, we did a metal back to total knee replacement. In the other knee, we did a all poly total knee arthroplasty. The reason why we did was because of the cost constraints. Some of the patients were not able to spend so much of money. So what we did was one knee acted as a case, the other acted as a control for each other. So it was a prospective study. And what study we did was an established treatment for osteoarthritis. But however, there was a control as well as a case. So this kind of studies is called case control studies. And this stays one step above the case control in the level of evidence. The strength will increase when you go higher above. Then after some time, what we found was that, okay, we wanted to see, is there any prevalence of osteoporosis and there is any occurrence of hip fracture in relation to osteoporosis. So we took a large geographical area like Madurai Taluk, and then we selected a population of around who are aged between 60 to 70 years of age, or who are born between 1960 to 1970. And then we collaborated all the risk factors and see that, is there any prevalence of osteoporosis? So in this MELI, we have a large cohort of patients who are similar in their clinical features, like in terms of risk factors, in terms of age, and then the prevalence of osteoporosis. And then these patients were monitored at a regular intervals over a period of time to see that, is there any association with of osteoporosis with the development of hip fractures, and then how do they follow it up? So then these kind of studies involve a cohort, a group of people participating in a study and who are being examined regularly are called as cohort studies. And this stays one step ahead of the level of evidence. Then after some time, what we did was that we wanted to see that intra-articular in peri-articular injection is going to benefit any patient in terms during the course of total knee replacement. So what we did was we choose a similar set of patients who are identical in terms of age, comorbidities, as well as other risk factors for the surgery. And then we randomized, means we randomly choose who is going to get an intra-articular injection and who is not going to get an intra-articular injection. At the same time, we didn't inform any of the patient who is going to get what. However, they signed the consent form that they are agreeing for any form of treatment. And then we found that after intra-articular injection, how the patients fared post-operatively. And this kind of studies are called as randomized control study. To tell you more simpler way of what is randomized control studies, you choose two twins and you institute treatment in one of them. The other one can act as a placebo or nothing at all and see how they fare over a period of time. This is called randomized control trials. And then last is this is meta-analysis. Already in the literature, there are large number of articles which has been published about probably screws and cement fixation for total knee replacement. Each surgeon will have 20, 30 cases. Some other surgeon will have 40 cases. If someone sits down and combines the data of all these papers and tries to publish a paper and try to give a best of those papers, then it becomes a randomized control trials. To give you an example, how they do randomized control, it's a meta-analysis. How they do meta-analysis is like they search MBES, Medline, and Cochrane, and all the articles have been filtered and then identify 12 studies with 13 publications. And you look at this, the number of cases will become 1,000 THRs. So automatically, the evidence becomes much more stronger. So they concluded that cross-linked poly reduced the radiological wear and osteolysis at mean of 5 years. So this is the highest level of evidence that is called meta-analysis of randomized control trials. to simplify it much more easier, we all have Gmail and we know that there are a lot of junk mails that is coming into your mail. But if you attach a spam filter, what it does, spam filter will filter all the bad mails and give you only the best of it. It's something, meta-analysis is also something like churning out all the journals and finding out what is the best evidence for a person to clinically practice. This is how meta-analysis come into vogue. And at the same time, based on these levels of publication, the strength of your publication will also increase from low, from a simple case report to very high, which is a randomized controlled trial. But the highest form of study is a double-blind RCT with a placebo. Sometimes this may not be possible in our clinical setting. However, definitely this is the highest form of any strength of the study that you're going to publish over a period of time. I think I have probably just in brief about how to do research in clinically and what are the levels of evidence so that that can be translated into your publication addresses. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, sir. I think I can proceed with my talk regarding how to do.
JV, yes, 2 minutes there.
Yeah, sure.
I think we have to really thank Dr. Somashekar. I think for all the postgraduates here, I think this is what is called as the levels of evidence. You have to decide whether you're going to do a case series, case study, case series, then RCT, then meta-analysis. So these words are again and again, it will be coming to your, you know, whenever you start reading articles, whenever you want to publish articles, the levels of evidence, what is your level of evidence? Are they in the, any, you know, drug trial or anything, they'll ask the levels of evidence. So if it is a level one, then you've got a very high level of evidence. And as he says, meta-analysis and randomized controlled trials, I think how to randomize. So I think, is there any particular thing, how to randomize these things? Or again, the randomization is going to be very random. So how, Dr. Somashekar, how do you think it's better to randomize, you know, put into
the randomization is a very difficult scenario, sir. You should have, if you want to blind those studies as well, it used to have a biostatistician. What you do is, first and foremost, you should define the parameters what you are going to choose for your study. Like, for example, is it osteoarthritis alone means it's a very big parameter. Then you have to shorten down something like those age group beyond 65 to 70, and then any other risk factors. And then yes, the more number of parameters you're going to do it, and then include the those only those kind of people in your study. And then it's something like, to in a simple words, you're using twins, sir, means they are identical or similar in their parameters. Then those kind of patients, then you get a consent saying that, okay, I'm willing for this treatment. And then there are something called randomization charts, or even it could be like simple things, sir. You put a chit on the day of the surgery for this patient and tell that she is going to get, or he or she is going to get a intra-articular injection or not. That is the most simplest way. In fact, there are softwares also. After you add the data, probably Jayesh Venkatesh will be able to in detail.
Telling that in detail, but in general, we can take odd even as randomization one after other. And this SSPS software has this randomization one. So once we enter the name of the next participant in the study, it will randomize something. And if you want, we can take whoever doing the research may not be doing, the others can take. And in Korea and all, they will have a small cover with, for example, I was involved in one study where the blood loss after TKA was analyzed, where they will give tranexamic acid in one group, the other group they will give one intravenous, the other group they will give only inside the knee joint. There they will open the cover only in the OT, and anesthetist will know that. And staff nurse will know, so the surgeon will not know that. So they are very, if we want to do, based on the computer also we can do, or simple we can follow this odd even rule kind of thing, or this collecting lots that we can do.
That's the simplest thing that you can do. SSPS software is a very good software. If it's, if an institute is there, they're able to buy it, and if a biostatistician is going to help you out, means then it is a very good software, sir. In fact, they say that even before you start your clinical study, you're supposed to talk with your biostatistician, because he is going to give you a fixed set of parameters, and based on those parameters, he is going to decide how many number of study subjects are required in your study. In fact, you will be thinking that 30 number is a very good number, but in fact, truly, if to get a statistically significant data, you may require some 44 or 46. So even before you start doing your clinical study, it is best you talk to a statistician, biostatistician, who is going to give fixed parameters and help you out. Based on it, you can start collecting data.
And PGs, I want you to be more interactive. You can ask your questions then and there. So this is a very informal talk, and there's nothing to be very serious about it. So whatever doubt you want, you can ask. And my one more doubt is RCT always prospective, or it can be retrospective?
No, sir. Always prospective, sir. RCTs are always prospective. There is no retrospective. The value comes down.
We cannot randomize, sir. After being a retrospective, we are collecting data. So we will know what is the data. So we cannot, will not be able to blind and randomize. So it will be a retrospective comparative study that we can do. Like two groups we can compare, that is possible. But the prospective should be like random, RCT should be a prospective study only.
But most of the theses I see, most of the theses are always been either prospective or retrospective. I'm very, very, very rare to see a thesis which is an RCT. So Yati, what Ram Prasad, you know, what do you think is the reason that why you were not able to give a thesis which with an RCT? We always say case study,
case series.
Have you ever given an RCT as a thesis to somebody?
The problem is most of the times we come across a few cases, and then we start thinking that okay, this study will be beneficial as a large group study. Therefore, we just the lack of time, we proceed with the patients operating and getting the follow-up studies and other things. And we, as J. Vengadesh and Somashekhar sir told, we fail to coordinate with a biostatistician. So before conducting any study, if we are able to organize a particular study biostatistician, then he will guide us what to do and what not to do and how to randomize and all these things. He will be able to guide us. But what we do is we just like that along the way we go and do the surgeries, and then suddenly we find that one particular type of surgery is in large numbers. Then we advise the postgraduate to take up that as a study and proceed with the thesis. So that may be the reason why we are not able to do randomize. It will take some extra time, coordination with SPM people. Of course, we have SPM people in our college, but we don't take pains to coordinate with them. That is the problem, I think.
And one more thing, JV, my question is, can meta-analysis be given as a thesis? Okay, so meta-analysis, you say it is the highest level of evidence. Okay. And can it be given as a thesis? So meta-analysis is, I understand, is a collection of all the articles. You compile, maybe, you read the article, and you give a, you know, your opinion or conclusion based on the meta-analysis.
It does not involve much work for the, other than organizing the data and analyzing and coming out with some conclusion. It doesn't actually work in the kind of some intervention or something. There won't be anything. Maybe for a postgraduate who's doing his thesis very well, he would have collected a lot of data in that, and you can encourage them to do a meta-analysis in that relevant topic which he is well-versed. That we can do. So that that will be an additional publication in addition to his the dissertation.
Yeah, I think one more question was there from Dr. Vinod. He says meta-analysis needs a very costly software. JV will be proceeding with that cost software part of it. So I think Dr. Vinod will understand once Dr. JV completes his talk. So I think this is a very valid point to encourage the PG not only to do his thesis, so also to do a meta-analysis of all the collection of all his articles. I think that is a very, very important point, I think, which is raised today. I think when you submit a meta-analysis, your citation and your levels of evidence are so high that when you can do a thesis, I think very easily, I think you can do a meta-analysis.
Yes.
I think that's a very important point. And so I think if there are no more questions.
I think meta-analysis is for the more experienced and expertised people.
So PG, the guide can do the meta-analysis.
Yeah, PG cannot learn everything in his 3 years course duration. And by the time he is going to complete his course, he might have got some 0.005% of orthopedic knowledge in his brain. With that knowledge, he will not be able to analyze all the, as Somasekhar sir told, we have to go into that base, we have to go into the midline, we have to search for the Cochrane, all these things, only the best journal publications we have to select. And from that, we have to understand what each author is going to say. And then we have to come to a conclusion whether what is correct and what is not correct. So to enumerate all the list of correct things and wrong things, the PG doesn't have that much of wisdom, I think, in his 3 years short period. There is one question for Somasekhar sir in his presentation.
Yes, sir.
Sir, actually, in your presentation regarding a case control study, that particular segment, you showed one example of all poly, comparing all poly with regular metal back thing, TKR.
Yes, sir.
And which one is the case and which is the control in this?
Sir, what we did was that initially what there is a smart story attached to it, sir. This happened way back in 2012, where there was sufficient funds for the total knee replacement given by the government in a government-sponsored scheme. So those days we were able to do all metal-backed knees. And then after some time, the same patients came back later. Probably the government changed or the attitude of the bureaucrats changed, and then they decreased the funding for those kind of knees. But the patients were insisting on getting the knees done. So then what we did was that, okay, this is what we are having. So metal, poly, all poly, because we didn't want to charge extra for the patients. So what we thought that we'll do all poly knees for these kind of patients. And we informed them that they are of the same company, but however, they look different on the x-rays, because that was supposed to be informed before. And because one intelligent lady came and asked us, my both the knees x-rays doesn't look the same, but however, my knees are fine. So in that way, what we did was one knee acted as a case and the other acted as a control in this kind of scenario. And we compared saying that which knees fare better. Like you ask the patient at the end of surgery without knowing what she is getting, which knee is much better. And then we clinically analyzed in terms of knee scores or something. And that was a very small study. Only a small group of patients were able to fit into it. And this is how in the same knee acted as a control for the other knee.
But in that case, is it possible to take all the comparative studies, for example, comparing a DHS with PFN? All the comparative studies can be clubbed together into the case control.
Yes, what happens is that the parameters should fit into it, sir. You can't just take all the patients with DHS. It could be a retrospective study comparing all the cases having been treated with this one. But always in your clinical practice, what you do is that for DHS will be given for a stable fracture and a PFLN for an unstable fracture. And you do a replacement for a type OTA type C3 or 4 or something like that. So in that way, again, that parameters changes. But if you are able to bring all those parameters in that fixed group, then probably you will be able to retrospectively collect those data and see that which patient has fared better than compared to other patients. That is possible. Only thing is, you can't just say that for stable fractures, I have done a DHS and then I'm comparing the same outcome with an unstable fracture which was treated by PFLN or a replacement.
So it doesn't necessitate to do both the surgeries or both the treatment modalities in the same patient?
No, it doesn't necessitate. It could be done. It only thing is that you have to fix the parameters and prospectively, like for example, there is a group of patients that come to your clinic and some of the patients are of the same age group, like 50 to 55 years of age, no major comorbidities, and then you randomize that patient, odd even, like what Jay Venkatesan. First patient of those patients who are coming, getting admitted on Monday, will get PFLN, and those patients getting admitted on Tuesday is going to get DHS. But only thing is, sir, in our cities, it is very much important that you should get the consent properly written. Obviously, many of us sometimes may not understand, and they may give a signature also, but it's in the our cities, you should make sure that the strength is very much high, but the consent and the acceptability of the patient is very much important for that. You can't, if the patient says that, no, I want only PFLN, means no, you have come on Tuesday, so you're going to get a DHS. That is also not a possibility. Obviously, in big inputs there.
You One second, Rampri. I think we are getting late. I think we'll finish off all the topics. And then I think we can note down the questions. I think we'll just go into the questions. I think, Devi, I think you can proceed, Devi. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So you're able to, are you able to see my screen, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay, you're seeing the Google Chrome page, right? Landing page with the take-home points, something like that, right?
Yes.
Okay, sir. So here, this presentation is made in Google Slides. That is what I wanted to, instead of opening the PowerPoint, this Google Drive has features like Google Docs, that is equivalent of MS Word, then Google Sheets, that is equivalent of PowerPoint, sorry, Slides. Sir, are you able to hear me?
JV, yes, ma.
Yeah, okay. So, yeah, this Google Docs is like a MS Word, Microsoft Word, and Sheets is Microsoft Excel, and Google Slides is the PowerPoint. So, if you do your academic work in these things, either of these three, you can easily share with your colleagues or even the professors and others in the department, and everybody can see your work. For instance, here this presentation is made in Google Slides. If I want, I can share with somebody, and others can also comment here. 2 days before presentation, if I want to get opinion from my senior colleague, I can just send it to him, and he can add comments in a respective slide. So this is how the collaboration works in online the Google Slides, like a PowerPoint. So let me start presenting. So, yeah, to begin with, I'm Dr. Jay Venkatesh. Thanks, Thiru sir, for the introduction. Actually, I was a student of Dr. Vittivel Chilian for maybe 3-4 months in Coimbatore Medical College before moving to Keel Park Medical College. By that time, he was doing some research in calcaneum CT scans, and I was on the way of getting his PhD. Thank you, sir, for being in this talk, participating here. So let's move on to the first slide. So generally, what is literature review? If you are not knowing something in the topic of interest, so you will search from the existing literature. So this is a connection between the known and unknown. It's not just adding up the data. You have to analyze it. That is what we will be seeing. So even if you're a practicing surgeon, even if you're not publishing, you have to be updated in order to provide current updated treatment for your patients. So doing literature review will be necessary often in clinical practice as well. Usually for writing a thesis or a journal article, people will do literature review, and for thesis dissertation. And if you're making any complex case scenario, if you're doing some intervention, then you have to search literature. And if you have new idea, in order to validate the idea, you should know the existing trends in that topic. So generally, literature review is divided into 5 steps. To start with, you should have a research question. That is, based on that only you can proceed further. Then you will search in the literature, either in the books or in the internet. Then you have to organize the information. Then the most important critical point is, you should synthesize results based on what you have organized so far. It's called critical appraisal. The next one is writing the comprehensive discussion or the review of literature part in the manuscript. So to begin with, the research question. Research question is basically for the postgraduate level, it is the aim of the study or the purpose or the objectives of the study. You should have the question generally how to find choose the topic. It should be relevant to the area of clinical practice and achievable within the time frame. Maybe 2 or 2 years, you should be able to complete this one, and answerable from the literature. There should be ample data. It should be easy for us to do the research. So this is the most important part, this literature search. So here in the internet, there are a lot of data. we can be broadly classified into scholarly and non-scholarly articles. So non-scholarly articles are magazine reports or some forwards or emails. So that it's not for scholars, and we should not quote them in your literature. That maybe that Times magazine has given this data. Those things should not be quoted. Preferably should avoid quoting non-scholarly articles. So scholarly articles are a lot. And with respect to orthopedics, ortho evidence from Dr. Mohit Bhandari in Canada, they are giving a concise evidence of the current literature. So it is all the postgraduates should once log into that and see whether their topic is there, so that they will know the latest consensus in the ortho evidence. So we will focus on Google Scholar and PubMed now. Yeah, so generally the sources for literature search, as we discussed earlier, it can be original research or case reports, case series or systematic reviews or consensus statements or any government WHO or some other government policies that can be there. There will be a lot of thing in the internet. You should have an organized search to should focus on what you want. It is called Boolean query and or not. These are called Boolean operators. This based on some coding system it acts. So if you want to search two words, if you just type two words, it will give a summation of the amount of results available for the two different words. But at the same time, if you want both the terms together, then you have to write and. So the number of results will be narrowed down to the results that are containing both the names together. And if you don't want something, for example, if you're doing some other, if you're seeing, for example, in a cricket player, if you want to see how much injury has happened in the, for example, in the bowling foot and wherever, whenever in the, for example, in the shoulder, whenever you search, the ankle or knee problems will come at the first. So if you want to avoid them, you can write cricketer injury and shoulder, not the ankle and knee part, so that those things will be eliminated and only focused result will come. So this is applicable for Google Scholar as well. So let's move to the PubMed. PubMed has a lot of tutorials in their landing page. Of course, this is the latest PubMed page will be live maybe on the next month. So this is old page. There are a lot of tutorials, PubMed tutorials available that will give idea about how to do this Boolean query and other things. And there are something called MeSH, medical subheadings. So if you use these keywords for searching, you will be able to find the relevant literature. There are actually librarians sitting in the National Medical Library, United States, and they will categorize each and every topic into various subheadings. If you use those subheadings, there are more likelihood that your article will be picked up by the search engines, either Google or PubMed. So you should try to use these subheadings for search as well as use the same subheadings as your keywords in the literature. And for the most important part of the literature search is to find the relevant article. For that, something called Bates model of berry picking. So what does it mean? If you have a single article in your hand, based on the article, you can find minimum of 20 to 30 relevant articles. So how do you do with the single article? If you see the references, that is the footnote. If you see the footnote, obviously original article will contain a minimum of 30 references. So from the references, you will get relevant to your research, maybe some 10 or 15. Then something called citation search. So if your article is in 2018, so for the next successive 2 or 3 years, 2019 and 2020, maybe five, six articles would have quoted this article. So in the Google search column, there is something called cited by. So if you click on the cited link, so you will be able to know what are all the articles that have quoted the current article. So based on that, you will find some articles. Then finally, author searching, either first author or corresponding author. If the more chances that the particular author is publishing more articles in that particular topic. So based on the Google Scholar, if you go to author's profile page or PubMed author search, you will find more articles. So this is how with a single article, you can proceed with multiple relevant articles rather than simply searching in the Google Scholar and PubMed. And if you see, this is a screenshot of my Google Chrome, where you can see Z is called Zotero, and the green color circle is Grammarly, and this mark is Google Scholar icon, and this is Skyhub. So you bookmark these tools in your Google Chrome, so that whenever you search the article, if you click Zotero, Zotero will automatically save that data in the Zotero software, and you can see it later. We will discuss this later. And collecting information, yeah, this is one other trick for Google Scholar. You can use this timelines, like since when you want to do. Preferably, you start with the recent articles and then go backwards to the old article. All the journal reviewers and editors want you to quote latest articles so that they are convinced that you have read the latest literature and you are up to date, and you are talking in the latest field of update in the relevant field. And the other point is, wherever you do search, please log in. Even Wikipedia has something called watch list. If you log in every time, then your history will be saved, and next time you need not, you can easily go through your the history with watch list, and you can find what you have searched earlier. So Google Scholar has something called history, and PubMed has the saved search. So all are free, Google Scholar and PubMed. You just have a login ID and login through that. And another feature in Google Alerts, in the Google Scholar itself, there is called Google Alerts. So if you want to, you have decided your thesis, and if you want to know the latest updates in that, you just type the name of the thesis and put alert. So every time the relevant article coming in that, it will be in your inbox, and you can see and you can get yourself updated. So Google Alerts is used. But if you keep so many alerts, even for authors, you can keep for particular authors. If you keep, then their publications will come to your inbox. Okay. So then Citation Manager, I was mentioning earlier, the Zotero, Mendeley is equally good. EndNote is a paid version. So either Zotero or Mendeley should do for routine postgraduate thesis. So what the screenshot shows is the Word document top page. So here you can see the Zotero is selected, and Zotero says you can add citation or enter the bibliography at the last from the Zotero. So in the internet, if you search something and if you save in the Zotero, it will be saved online and also in your computer if you're doing from your computer. So whenever you're typing your thesis, at relevant points, if you want to insert something, you can just click on the add citation, Zotero will open, you can write the author's name, it will be automatically added. What is the advantage of this one rather than doing manually adding references? Because at the end, if your guide says, okay, you delete this paragraph and we'll proceed with some other thing, then all the three or four references which you have quoted in the text will be lost. So entire numbering will be changed in the end. So preferably, if you use Zotero, Zotero will automatically remove the references in the references list, and whatever you add new will be added in that space. So in that sense, it makes life easier. So it online, it syncs journals, books, and web pages of interest. You can access anywhere in the selector, you can access anywhere, and it adds bibliography. Even in Google Docs, you can have a Zotero add-on. For example, this is one of the screenshots showing my Zotero page. Here you can see in the Zotero, there is my library. So here is the area where what are all the topics of your interest. And in each topic, these are the articles I have from the internet I have saved in Zotero. So if we select one, that particular topic, who is the author, what is the title, which year it has come, all this data will be seen here. Even you can take notes in this Zotero. So this is a useful tool, free tool available for the researchers. So usually till this part, it is very easy. People can do collecting data. It's accurate or not, collecting data is easy. We can take multiple printouts and keep. But the next part is the most crucial, is analyzing the, organizing the data and analyzing the data. So organizing the data is, rather than, of course, you can, in the traditional way, you can underline in printouts, but even in PDFs, you can use the highlight column and you can highlight and save the PDFs. Google spreadsheet comes handy. That is the best way to organize information. And you relate the organization based on your question. Here you can see the, for example, like name of the author, then the study design, objective, what is the study population, the, that results have come, sample size, outcomes, author's conclusion. So these things you can write, and in some other order, whether in the order in which you are finding the article or maybe in chronological order. But once you collect the data, try whenever you read some article relevant to your topic, you please add to the Google Sheets, so that you will not forget and the data will be formatted, separated, and organized in that Google Sheets. And the next part is critical appraisal. Critical appraisal is just analyzing what you have learned so far. So, you have organized here, and you have to do the appraisal. Appraisal means, it is like identifying the strength and limitations of each study. Carefully examine the information in the article with relevance to your research question. So this is what Vitriol Challenge Survey is telling. You have to compare with the existing literature to your data. And you should compile in one place. For example, your valuables, the reference data value. The mean standard deviation of your data and the reference data. So like that, for every parameter, if you're seeing some 4 or 5 parameters, functional outcome, the age, and what are all the variables you're seeing. So you have to compare with the literature, the most important landmark articles that have come in last 5 years. So that you have to take for consideration. And the important point is, if you are citing some author, you should have read that article fully. Don't just cite an article since you have seen that reference in some other article. It is not fair. And there have been instances that the multiple citations were there, but the original article could not be found. So author should read the full text and not just the abstract before quoting in his or her literature. So this is, for example, the Google spreadsheet or docs. You can collaborate with the authors. I will show some live Google Sheets. So here, as an example, author name, article title, year, what is the design, study design, what is the objective. So like that, you can have your own sheet and you can share with your guide or with your friend, so that they can add their whatever data they found it. It is similar to Google Excel, Microsoft Excel, but it is shareable and editable by everybody, even simultaneously from different locations. And the write-up. It's like once you have done all these things, it's very easy. I would recommend everybody to do Google Docs, unless your research is some path breaking, which wants patent and intellectual property has to be saved, then don't use this in an online thing. But otherwise, generally, we can use Google Docs. It is better for easy sharing and editing from even phone and other all devices. So review should be coherent and systematic. Make sure you answer the research question, quote latest publication, and don't hesitate to express negative findings, even if you have had complications or if your data is not matching with the data from the other most important studies. You should try to tell the readers that yours is different, but we think that these are the reasons because of which my results are different from the landmark article. So that is how you should substantiate. The negative side is, if you're not quoting the contradicting findings, the editors and reviewers who are expert in the field will say, oh, this guy doesn't know that there is some contradicting finding to his study. He is only telling his findings are good. So that should not be the case. You should be able to find the other side of the discussion, and you should quote that. And references should be added then and there. Otherwise, your article will be seen as a similarity index will be shown in the plagiarism check. So there are many tools available. One such is Enago. There are checklists for beginners. So while writing this review, then they will say these are all the parameters you should check. And Government of India has something, Swayam course. It's free of cost. It's by the SPM guys from ICMR and other important government organizations. And it's free of cost. And even they conduct exams. Those some universities make it compulsory for postgraduates to clear that exam. And NAPTEL is also a government initiative. It's all free courses regarding this research methodology. So finally, to conclude regarding this review of literature, it's important both for the practice and research. There are scholarly and non-scholarly. We should focus only on scholarly articles. There are 5 steps. First is define research question, gather information. You use and or not Boolean operators, use Zotero. Google and organize data using Google spreadsheets, and write your thesis in Google Docs after summarizing the results and critically analyzing the facts. So yeah, let me, before finishing, I will just give you a quick idea about the literature search in the internet. For example,
JV. Dr. Somashekar.
Yes, sir.
Jay Venkatesh has experienced some power failure.
Okay, sir.
So I don't, Jay, I think he's come back. I think he's okay, come back. Neenga, JV Vandiya.
If he's there, then it's okay.
JV?
You unmute yourself, sir. You are in mute state, sir.
Illaye.
JV, unmute, sir. JV Venkatesh. Okay.
Sir, am I audible, sir, now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes, yes. JV, yeah.
Hello, sir.
JV, kekudhu. JV, kekudhu.
Okay, sir. அதான் இப்போ நான் இந்த இது மட்டும் ஒரு ரெண்டு மூணு எக்ஸாம்பிள்ஸ் மட்டும் காமிச்சிடறேன் சார் ஷேர் ஸ்கிரீன்ல போட்டு.
ஷூர் ஷூர்.
ஓகே சார். இப்போ சோ இஃப் யூ வாண்ட் டு சர்ச் சம்திங் இன் தி ஃபார் எக்ஸாம்பிள் லைக் தேர் இஸ் இன்டர்நெட் கனெக்டிவிட்டி இஸ் புவர். யா. தேர் இஸ் சம்திங் கால்ட் ஸ்கைஹப். மேபி தி கரண்ட் போஸ்ட் கிராஜுவேட்ஸ் மைட் பி நோயிங். Not sure whether the professors and others are aware of this. The SkyHub. Yeah. So if you see here, this is one of the publications I have made. So you cannot see the full text. It says that you have to buy the article or something. This is, I'm not saying this is the correct way, but for a postgraduate who is in need of the paper, you can use this SkyHub. Where if you use the SkyHub and if you enter the DOI number, SkyHub is from Russian scholars. They usually get information from various publishers. So if you enter the DOI or URL or even the PMID, so automatically this will open the main full text article. So even you can have this SkyHub as an add-on in your Google Chrome, and once you open some article, you can click on the SkyHub and it will open into this page. So this is one trick to get full text. The other ways are you can even mail the authors directly, or you can ask your friends abroad to send the details. This is one thing. The other one is if this is the page which I was showing earlier, if I want to save this page, I can click here. If you could see here, there is one column, it shows Zotero. So I think you cannot see the Zotero now. Okay, Zotero is a software which you can install in your computer. It is free of cost. If you have installed in your computer and you have logged in, then the add-on will be synced. Even internet from my computer or in any other computer, if you log in there, it will automatically sync with the Zotero. And you can save this particular topic to the already pre-existing folder in the Zotero. So this is one easy way where you can organize things easily. The other point which I wanted to tell is the Google Scholar. Yeah. So even if you do a general search, so this is a routine Google search which everybody we do. So if you have a Google Scholar add-on here, plugin, so if you click that, so the Google Scholar will find a relevant article in this particular topic. So you will directly go to the scholarly articles and you will avoid non-scholarly articles. So this is an advantage of having a Google add-on. And regarding this Google Sheets, I was telling, it's an online document. Yeah. So this is for another study, I collected data. So here you can use the author name, article title, year, objectives, sample, other things. And as and when you read the study, you can just dissect it and you can add in the relevant area. So yeah, you can have a link also. So that you need not again search. You can just copy paste the DOI or the URL link. And every time you want to go there, you just click on the link and your main article you will find. And there are features like in this, if the first call in order to, there are a few, one or two points regarding this Google spreadsheets. There is something called a freeze in the format, I think in the tools column. There is something called freeze. If you click that, so you will not be, the first column will stay, so that even if you have 50 citations, the first column, what is the first column, you will be able to know. That is freeze. The other one is merge. If you this is called merge, text wrapping. If text wrapping is on, you will see entire thing in one box. If the text wrapping is not there, you will be missing many words in the sentence. So preferably you can use text wrapping feature so that you will be able to see the entire thing in a single go. So text wrapping and freeze the first column will be easier. And this is organizing the literature in the Google spreadsheets. So these are the ones I wanted to tell. And that is so since we have come to this, I will show the explore option in the Google, explore options in the Google Sheets. See, for example, in the same Google Sheets, in this particular sheet, you can see the data of a study where age, weight, and the hemoglobin, other details are entered. So it's here. So usually for statistical analysis, as like you're doing in the Google, in the Microsoft Excel, if you want to compare two variables, for instance, if you want to compare these two variables, you can select and then put explore option. So explore option will show the possible comparison between the two selected variables. So it will give the sum, average, minimum, maximum, and then it will show the relevant graphs for the data which you have collected. So on a single go, within a same collection of data, you'll be able to compare two different columns, and even within a single column, you will be able to know the minimum, maximum, sum, and mean, all those things. So these are the features that I want to tell in Google spreadsheets. And since we have come so far, I'll tell about Google Docs also, so that I don't know whether the internet will be good the next time. So Google Docs is the equivalent of Microsoft Word. See, for example, this is one of the study which I have, it's in the correction process. It's been accepted by a journal, but not published yet. So here, if this is the, you can write all the data from the starting, from the end, all the manuscript in Google Docs itself. Here also you can see the share column, you can share. If I want to comment something about any of the particular topic, if the professor wants to comment to the student, he can just click the comment section and he can add, okay, change something, change to this. Then this will be shown in the to the student also. So in this way, the easier interaction will happen between the professor and the students. Also, lively, you can see whatever changes you are making, the other person can easily see. There, I'll tell some few features which are useful. This is as like in Word, you can use the title, subheading, everything. So at the end of the study, if you click on this, you'll be able to see what are all the various subheadings which you have added. You can add the diagrams also in this and tables. You can make tables, discussion, everything, like just like MS Word. And yeah, here there's references. See, this references in this manuscript been entirely done by Zotero. So Zotero is here. So if I click Zotero, it will add the citation and other things. For example, I don't know whether it's synced. Here, if you see, there are 22 references till here. if I'm adding some reference somewhere. For instance, yeah, here in the discussion column there will be some references. So I will add one reference and see whether it is getting inserted for the demonstration purpose. So for example, this is 16. If I want to add something here, so I'll go to Zotero, add citation. If it is synced well, it will open. Okay, it asks me to So Zotero will get automatically synced from the internet and also from my laptop, and it will ask the name of the author which I want to quote here. So once I enter the name of the author, here, so I will randomly write some mark. So if there are authors in this name, so it will show where, what are all the authors in this name. So I can choose the author name and I can enter. So Zotero will update the author name in the relevant area. So here, from this is was 16, so the next one is 16. Maybe because of internet, it has come. So here in this article, the numbering is done not in the order of insertion of article, but in some other, as per the journal's requirement. So the particular citation has been inserted inside the Zotero. So this is how we use citation manager, then the title and other subheading part, then data sharing and commenting option. Comment you can do here also. Whatever you want to comment, you can comment. So that's all about Google Spreadsheets, Google Docs, and Zotero. Thank you, sir. So we can proceed with the next presentation. The main topic regarding manuscript writing for every heading, for the title, what you have to write, for the introduction, background, discussion, materials, methods, is my next talk. So maybe after sir winds up quickly, I will also do it quickly because it's getting late. I'm now sharing my slide. Stopping my slide share.
Thanks, JV. Thank you very much. I think we'll continue with the next talk. Okay. Finish off the entire talk and then we have questions. I think we can go ahead.
Okay, sir. I'll go with my talk. thank you once again. Am I visible, sir?
Yes. You are, sir.
Visible and audible. Okay, right,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah.
this is a talk similar to what we have done it in last TNOCon. This is a more of an informal talk rather than a formal method by which research has to be done. This talk will be basically concentrating on how you should not do research and what are the ethics of doing research in your clinical practice. So what is the basic definition of any ethics is that it's a very simple definition, right or wrong of an action. And if you do apply the same thing in medical and biological research, then it is called bioethics. The earliest code of ethics was introduced by Charaka way back in 10,000 BC. And he said that a doctor should pledge himself to the relief of patient, and he should not abandon your patient, should not take sexual advantage, and he shouldn't treat a woman without an husband or a relative. Then came the Hippocratic Oath, which we are taking among hostels for all MBBS students and also clinical practitioners. The original article was like this: first, do no harm, maintain confidentiality of the patient, and act in the best interest of the patient. No abortion or euthanasia should be done. Coming to the pre-World War ethical research, it was through research only Edward Jenner was able to invent a smallpox vaccine. And then coming to Claude Bernard, much of our physiology, what we are learning or what we are practicing these days, was due to the contribution of Claude Bernard based on his articles written as ethical maximus. However, some of his practices were not being accepted even those days as well as today as well. Because, for example, to prove that lung is an organ of respiration, he slit open the trachea of a dog and then pumped air into it. Because earlier people used to think that esophagus is an organ of respiration. So it was Walter Reed who invented yellow fever, was the first to introduce the concept of consent. This was the first consent that was written, in which the consent was taken from the volunteers. Basically, they were migrant workers working from Latin America, and they were told that they were aware of the endangering his life, and if at all if they get sick, they'll be given $100 gold coins, and in case of death, 250 gold coins were issued. And this consent was also taken in the language which the patient understood, and live virus was injected into the volunteers. Nobody can forget World War II and the experiments done by Nazi doctors in Dachau. What they did was they wanted to see that is German soldiers fit to travel across the Atlantic? Were they able to sustain high altitude, and they sustain any hypothermia, how to treat them? So what these Nazi doctors did was they did a lot of these experiments on Romanian gypsies. They thought that they are not worthy of living. So in the melee, a lot of people were killed. We all think that it was only Nazis who did the experiments. In fact, Japanese also did some experiments on prisoners of war. In fact, there was a separate unit to do this biological warfare and experiment research. It was called as Unit 731. They took Chinese and Russian prisoners of war, and they injected bubonic plague. They did chamber experiments. They in fact did vivisection of the prisoners. And this is almost well described and published in a book called Unit 731, The Forgotten Asian Auschwitz. In fact, it is called as Asian Auschwitz as well. Nobody should and will ever forget Joseph Mengele for his twin studies in Auschwitz. This guy, what he did was he took Jewish twins, and they did some barbaric experiments. Like he stitched the two twins to see the effect of conjoined twins. And in fact, he chose something like this. One of the twin acted as a case, the other acted as a control. One of the twin injected a live virus or a chemical into the body, and then at the end of the study, he killed both the children, both the twins, and then cross-checked the organs of these kids to see what is the effect that has occurred following the injection of the virus. However, the most unfortunate thing is that he was never tried in the history or in any court. Following World War II, what happened is that there was an international military tribunal which conducted Nuremberg trials in 1946, in which they tried almost 20 German doctors, in which 16 were convicted and 7 were sentenced to death, and they charged them of performing medical experiments upon concentration inmates without their consent. In the due course, they were subjected to murder and torture. And you look at these photos of the trial doctors, they didn't show any remorse or any guilt for it. In fact, some judge even asked him, why don't you ever feel a guilt? They told, yes, we don't feel it, for the reason because they were just following the higher orders. And then came the following this trial came the Nuremberg Code in 1947. And this became the first internationally recognized code of research, that how you should conduct a research, and it became an ethical yardstick. And the code includes a lot of points, but the key points are very simple. You should take voluntary consent from your participants. Benefit should always outweigh the risks, and the ability of the subject to terminate participation at any point of time, even before, during the course, and after the study as well. Only qualified person should conduct the experiment, not everyone. No death or disability should be an end point of your study. And then came the World Medical Association Declaration of Helsinki. It was just a continuation of the earlier code of conduct. However, what they did was that you should respect a human being, and then consent should be in writing. You should always limit the number of placebo as much as possible, and the participants should also benefit from the research. This was not at all followed in Jewish Chronic Research Hospital in New York, in which 22 elderly patients were injected with live cancer cells. But if you look at the profile of the patients, many of them were demented and they spoke Yiddish. No review committee or approval was taken, and the consent was taken in English. In fact, those guys, those old people were speaking only Yiddish. So this was how the consent was not properly taken in this study. Then we all know the Tuskegee experiment, the infamous syphilis study. I'll just go through the chronological order in which the study was done. It started way back in 1932. It was called Tuskegee syphilis study, in which 400 men with syphilis and 200 without were given only periodical assessment, and they were told that they are being treated. They were never given any drug or medicine for their illness. In fact, it went on till 40 years, till 1972, that these patients were not at all being treated over a course of time. However, if you look at the timeline, by 1945 itself, penicillin was an accepted form of treatment. However, these guys were not treated. Just the researchers wanted to know the natural history of syphilis. So it became so big a scandal that Clinton has to give a public apology in 1997 with $9 billion compensation. You look at all the participants here, they're all sitting in a wheelchair. Probably they were suffering from tertiary syphilis. Then came the Belmont report. It stood on three basic principles. One is respect for a person, means an individual autonomy should be respected, and there should be maximum benefits and minimal harm, and justice, equitable justice should be done. Later on, they added one more point called non-maleficence, in which what they did was that in order to give a very statistically significant difference, you should not use too many number of subjects. Use as minimal as possible so that you ensure a scientifically valid data. Then came the WHO guidelines. It was just a continuation of the earlier guidelines, but however, they added one very important point. Probably this accepts very well for Indian scenario. For example, if a trial is conducted in Europe and then they have found a statistically significant data, they can't translate the same data into Indian population. Here, they have to do a separate study. They have to get an ethical board review of Indian government or probably the Indian setup. And then they are supposed to constitute that as a definitive treatment. So it's a population-based and country-based study as well. Coming to the last but not the least, the Indian scenario, ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, is the nodal agency, and they have released three booklets, one related to research involving children, the other one related to stem cell research, and the main part is the basic research guidelines for human participants. In fact, it is 180 pages booklet, and it is highly impractical to discuss all the points in this short setup. So I'd like to touch upon only key points here. What are the principles of any research is that you should have a benefit risk assessment should be done before itself. This was brazenly misunderstood and was not followed in thalidomide study, in which thalidomide was introduced as a sedative. In fact, it was called as a wonder drug for cure of morning sickness. In the course of time, almost 10,000 children in 46 countries were born with deformities such as facomilia. So they didn't assess the risk-benefit ratio. So then the drug was withdrawn in 1961. Then informed consent. It's a very much important that relevant information should be told to the patient in a language which he understands. And after that, his voluntariness to the participation, it should be mentioned. Way back in 1965 itself, Henry K. Bleacher published this very important article, and he found that 22 published medical studies providing risk to the patients without the approval of the knowledge, means the consent was not taken properly. And it was published in very big journals like JAMA, Lancet, and so forth. Like some of the examples that he quoted was that heart catheterization was done in a patient getting bronchoscopy, bladder cauterization in newborn to study vesicoureteric reflex in the melee, exposing many of them to x-rays. And then soldiers dividing into groups getting streptococcal infection treatment. In fact, streptococcal infection, penicillin is an accepted form of treatment, but still they were dividing them into groups to see the effect. Then comes the special issue about vulnerable population or age groups. Who are they? They are children, women, tribal and mental illness affected individuals. In these, when you are doing research in these kind of population, you should make sure that you should get additional consent. In fact, there is a new rule saying that if the child is between 7 and 18 years, a separate consent apart from the parent's consent is a necessary and a must. So if you are doing a pediatric orthopedics study, probably you need to get a consent both from the parent as well as the child itself. Always the benefit should be far more better than what is accepted. And there should be a repeated education, in-depth IEC discussion should be done, and continuous monitoring and reporting should be done with responsibility. Privacy and confidentiality of the patient is of paramount importance in the medical research. This was not done, especially in Havasupian Indian tribe case. In this native tribes of America, initially when the study started, they collected the blood saying that they're going to check the incidence of. However, over a period of time, they published a data saying that these tribal population have high susceptibility to develop schizophrenia. So a learned member of the tribe discovered this, saying that this tribal population is more susceptible to schizophrenia. That was not taken in their consent forms. In fact, they were so enraged that they went to University of Texas and Arizona, and they took all their blood samples, and they told that they would not to cooperate in any future studies. So it is always important the confidentiality of the patient is very much maintained throughout the study. Distributive justice is that you are doing a study or a research in a third world country, and you are publishing the data in a developed country, and then the patients from that third world country should also get the benefits. This was not followed in Guatemala syphilis experiments, where volunteers like soldiers, prostitutes and prisoners were infected with gonorrhea and treated with antibiotics. However, in the nearly 83 patients were died during the course of, and this was done by this infamous guy called Cutler, and this lady identified that in fact American government gave a public apology for not doing good for the patients of Guatemala. Also, when you are doing research, you should always pay for the participation, and if there is any research related harm, you should always pay for the compensation as well. Then one small story is that Henrietta Lacks was an African-American lady. She went to John Hopkins Hospital for bleeding per vagina, and then they took the blood sample, and they were able, for the first time in the history, they were able to culture cancer cells in the laboratory. It became the famous HeLa cell line. Over a period of time, Henrietta Lacks was forgotten. It was Rebecca Scoot who identified that the family members of Henrietta Lacks were in downtrodden poverty. However, John Hopkins University received in billions as research funding from the government of USA, and automatically nobody was compensated for it. After this, they were supposed to give a certain amount of compensation for the family members of this, and this has been beautifully written in the book.
Dr. Somasekhar, sorry to interrupt. Can we do a little fast?
This is the last slide, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, sir. And then whenever you're going to give a treatment, when you're the research related participant should also give the treatment, should be instituted treatment free of cost. And also there should not be any conflict of interest in your study. Means based on the funding, you should be very careful in not to give a biased data at the end of your study, which was not followed in this study in the first paper itself. And these are the guidelines for any researchers. And to end my talk, all the material which I have quoted, ICMR guidelines, everything is available online free of cost. Thank you very much, sir. Sharing, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. There's a little bit of shortage of time, yes. So I think thank you so much for your elaborate presentation. I think we'll finish off the last topic by JV.
Okay,
JV,
sir.
Yeah. Go ahead, JV.
So are you able to see my slide?
No. Not at slide, sir. Varla.
Okay. Wait a minute. It says other participant.
I think he has to stop sharing.
Yeah. Is it okay, sir, now?
Yeah, it's coming.
Okay, sir. So, of course, many of the participants will be eager to know about this manuscript writing pertinent to the journals. So it is important for both for the students and for the publication nowadays become important both for the students in all layers of academic, the either assistant professors and professors do need this. So yeah, the next. So once the data is ready, if your study is over, if you've done your thesis and you have the data in hand, it's measurable data in forms of some scoring or the age and other parameters, hemoglobin or whatever parameter of your interest based on your study. Once these are ready, you should finish the writing within 2 or 3 months. That is the ideal time. Because if you keep dragging more than 6 months, you will lose interest and you will forget over the relevant literature which you have gained earlier. So split among work among the authors. So outline of this talk will be like how you see a journal from the title till the references, what are all the topics you will see. So we will discuss one by one how it can be written in a better way. So we will have some common idea after reading so many articles, we ourselves will have some idea. Still from a reviewer's perspective or from a publisher's perspective, what the editors will want from the author, I will try to summarize. So to start with the title, title of the study can be written in 3 ways. One, you can describe the study. For instance, you can say if you are comparing PRP effectiveness in tennis elbow, you can straight away tell that we are comparing and it is a prospective randomized control study. So this is one way, right? You can describe the study. The other way is it can be an interrogative way. You can ask a question to create some interest in the reader. So is it superior? Is it working? This kind of questionnaire can be there. And the last one is you just tell the conclusion that this is working or this is not working. These are the 3 common ways a title of the study can be designed. So next to that is the authorship. You will see the name of the authors below. So this International Committee for Medical Journal Editors clearly says who is qualified for an author. You can go to the guidelines and authors affiliation should be written. Even authors can be from different multiple locations. Even if the study is done in single center, that has to be mentioned in the text. And the authors can be from different locations. The source of funding, if any grant from ICMR or DBT or DSD, if there is any grant, it has to be mentioned. And disclaimer, if the senior author is getting royalty from particular drug company or from implant company, that has to be mentioned. And all authors should have ORC ID. This is like a Twitter or Facebook ID for general population. For the journal researchers, this ORC ID, ResearchGate, Figshare, all these platforms, you can sign in and have your own account. So in that account, you will be given a number. Most publication houses want the authors to submit their ORC ID so that they can see your previous publications and your qualification based on that. Caliber, they will judge from the ORC ID. But anyway, it is better to have this one. So as years go, you will keep adding your the number of papers and your Hutch index will go high. So abstract. The next comes the abstract. It's like a trailer to the movie. So here I've written 250 words. Generally, an original article is expected to be within 3000 or 4000 words. So in that, abstract is not counted. Usually from the introduction, they will say. And abstract should be 250 to 300 words. Clear, concise guidelines. It should be clear and concise. Follow the guidelines from the author guidelines in the every journal. What I'm giving is a generalized guideline, but it will vary from journal to journal. My professor used to say that you should write in AIIMS, they say you first finish the abstract part from AIIMS, Mitchell's methods, discussion and conclusion. In the abstract, it will be 2 or 3 sentences only. If you are very well oriented and if you have written the abstract well, It's like developing hints from the abstract. You can write the rest of the manuscript. And some journals require in IMRD format, introduction, materials and methods, results and analysis and discussion. And there should not be any abbreviations, need not put references or images, and need not put all the data in the abstract. I have told earlier regarding this MESH terms, medical subheadings. So for each and every topic, more important topic, there are MESH subheadings. You can follow that. Usually 5 keywords are allowed. You try not to use the same word which is already mentioned in the title, so that the search engines will, you will have more keywords to the search engine for your article to get picked up by those engines. If you use the same heading in the title and again the same in the keywords, you are missing an opportunity to the of visibility to your article. So better not to have an overlap of the words in keywords and title. Yeah, this misshared heading. Then comes the introduction or the background part. So here you should bring attention of the reader to why you have started doing this study, what makes you to come to start this study, that kind of things. So usually this is 3 paragraphs. The first paragraph will be like you state the current problem, what is the existing treatment for that particular pathology which you are treating, or what is currently happening in the recent developments. And in that, what is the thing which you think is missing? So there is a lacuna in the literature. So this is the gap you are finding, and you should try to fill the gap by your research. And you should state your hypothesis. For example, this intervention works in this study. Also, we hypothesis like that. So you should tell, and you preferably quote latest references. Introduction comes with 500 words. The aim of the study. So there are 2 scenarios I have given. One is to compare the clinical outcome of DHS and PFN for treatment of IT fracture. The other one is to compare the DHS PFN in terms of. So here we have added the outcome parameters. Operation time and blood transfusion rate and hospital stay. So these are the parameters which we are going to study. And you have to add the study subject. So in which patient you are doing, in patients with unstable intertrochanteric fracture. So you should add the primary research question which should include key outcome variables, and it would include the description of the study subject. So this is called the aim of the study. Next, the materials and methods part. Yeah, here you have to write your the way your intervention, how did you do these things to be written. And if you have done some modification from the standard technique, that has to be written so that the other future researchers should be able to replicate your study. So that is the purpose of writing the methodology, methods. Materials means the patients and method. Patients, you have to write the sample size. How do you select the ethical committee approval and consent? If you're doing, as sir was discussing, if you're doing randomized control studies, there is something called clinical trials registry. For India also, there is registry. In the US maintains no international registry. You have to register all the studies. The important studies has to be registered in that before the start itself. And that number has to be included in ethical committee approval, preferably. And they will also give a separate clinical trial registry approval form. And write the technical information regarding the study design, what are the outcome scores you are doing, and the details of the surgery. Statistics with the help of a statistician, you have to do. And usually, if you have SSPS will have a 1 month trial version. So if the data collection is over, if somebody won an email ID, you can have 1 month trial. So with multiple email IDs, you will have multiple 1 month trial, and you can finish your thesis. And it is, even that is not mandatory. Even with Google spreadsheet and Excel, you can do most of the functions which we are doing for the thesis level. So the results, you should describe the key findings. Whatever you have written in your aim of the study, the 2 or 3 parameters which you want to read, the outcome variables, that should be highlighted in the results column in the form of tables and illustrations. Here for the tables, either in the caption or a footnote, should be clear for the publication. They will want the table should be addressed well in the manuscript as well. There have been many instances that I do review for a few journals. If you read the manuscript, there won't be any insertion of figure number and table number. But at the end of the manuscript, there will be figures, 2-3 figures or tables. So that is not the way. The table, relevant table number should be inserted in the pertinent column in the Word. And there is an option in the Word so that if you click the figure number, automatically that figure will open in the Word. So that has to be, insertion has to be clear. So once you have written results, usually in 500 words, and don't discuss anything, don't compare anything with the existing literature in the results column, or even within the same study, if there are differences also, you need not explain why that difference has happened. And don't fear about the negative results. As I have mentioned in my previous talks, negative results has to be mentioned, and you should try to tell why there was some kind of difference of results, and you try to elaborate on that. So we have seen earlier regarding the Google Docs, and this is MS Word, the traditional way which we write. So I put this slide to show about some features of MS Word that will be useful for the manuscript writing. For example, from the left to right, there is some spelling check and grammar check. Even though there is Grammarly in the right hand side column, both works for spell check and grammar checks, you can use that. And the word count, you can select something and see the word count for that particular, and also the overall word count also you can see in order to stay within the limits of the journal's requirement. And this is review column, this most important part. What we have seen earlier in Google Docs is the comment section. So here, that comment section, you can select and you can comment here, but it will not be shared unless you send through email to the person which you want to discuss. But there is something called comment section here. Can delete the comment and you can go successively. Here, this article was sent from the reviewers for improvement. So you can see multiple reviewers has given multiple comments, and the author has to respond every comment and he has to say what change has been made in the text. And the next one is Zotero. You can see we have discussed earlier that can be added as a plugin in MS Word as well. So whenever you add some citation, automatically Zotero will update. So here 4, 5, 9. So if you add one more thing, the 10th one or the whatever number based on the referencing style, it will get added. And not if you insert bibliography, if you click on insert bibliography in the end part also, that bibliography will get updated automatically. If you delete, that will get deleted automatically. And there is one column called track changes. So here I have written on this, it is like final, showing final markup. So you, in this part, if you have switched on track changes from the time which you have received the topic, the manuscript till you are sending back, what are all the changes you have made will be easily traced by the other person. So many reviewers want this track changes to be switched on so that they can know what changes author has made to the existing journal. So this is the MS Word review track changes and important features, markup features. So, yeah, the discussion part after results, so comes the discussion part. Discussion part, you restate the problem. So this is the most important part that decides the acceptance or refusal of your paper. If your your study question is of interest to the reviewer or the editor, they will send to the reviewers, and if they find the discussion part convincing, then there are more chances that your article will get published. So you restate the main question, the background, what you have written, you just rephrase it and write it here, and take results one by one in a logical sequence for easy understanding, and discuss with the existing literature. And it should be of 100 words usually, and use references correctly so that it won't be picked up by the plagiarism software, and write the limitations, usually like a small sample size or large, whatever the limitations. If the study methodology could not follow the standard methodology, you have to mention it here. And after the discussion part comes the conclusion. Conclusion should be derived from your findings, and don't write a generalized data in the conclusion. Whatever conclusion you're writing, that should be backed up from your data and based on your study question and the main outcome variables, that has to be a part of conclusion. And of course, you can give future directions like large randomized studies, you can tell. Acknowledgement part, as we are telling, as I have discussed earlier, those who have helped in the manuscript but does not fit into authorship criteria. For instance, biostatistician or some research coordinator who has taken filled all the data for a scoring system, physiotherapist who have done, those persons you can acknowledge in the study. Or if some big person has helped you in the surgical part, then of course you can thank them in the acknowledgement part. Other project grants and intellectual support providers. Usually it is not for those who are not involved in the study, like dean or like a director of the hospital, need not be, and not for thanking the, it's not like the foreword written in the book, so it should not be done. The next comes the references. We have dealt earlier also. Usually 5 to 8 references are for case reports, original research 30 to 40, and review articles go up to 100 or more. And various styles are there. In the Google, if you see the name of the, like if or a particular topic, there will be something like a cited by. I have told earlier, if you click cited by, you will know what are all the articles that have quoted the current article of interest. And there is two of first of these, the comma. If you click that, it will show how to cite this particular paper. So there are various styles. If you are doing manually, if you're not using Zotero or Mendeley, then you can copy paste this in the text. So this is the citation styles, where usually Vancouver in the superscript is commonly followed. So this finishes the manuscript writing main part. Then, of course, revising and editing. Once you have written the manuscript, you of course revise yourself multiple times and send to the friends and mentors, and change, usually avoid we write authors, and change from passive voice to active voice. We are not native English speakers, so preferably cut short your sentences to simple sentences. Grammarly and other spell checks softwares can be used. Most journals recommend a font size 12, double spacing, and line numbers are important. We have seen earlier this one. Here you can see the line number. So only with the line number, the communication is easier. Otherwise, you cannot say the fifth line in the fourth paragraph. It will be difficult for the both of the concerned persons to understand. So line number is possible in Google Word, Docs, and MS Word both. And side headings, I have told earlier, and count each section. So plagiarism is detected by the software when you quote some existing literature without giving credit to them. And usually softwares don't bother whether you have written that you have quoted them or not. So preferably most journals request plagiarism should be less than 15% or maximum 20%. So if there is more coincidence and from a particular journal, plagiarism should be less than 5%. You cannot copy a single journal and make discussion part from a single journal. It's not good. And in order to avoid plagiarism, if you want to quote something, you better, if continuous 6 words are in the same format, then it will be picked up by the software. So just rephrase the sentences and you can add it. So these are various. I think Orkund is being given to the postgraduates of MGR University now. When I was postgraduate, Turnitin was given, the password was given. There is for those who don't have the access, this copy leaks is very good. It has limited number of words for every email ID you can do, and even the costing is very less. CopyLeaks is a good plagiarism software. The other things are not very good. The Dupli Checker and Viber are not very good because it is mainly for other journals, the social sciences journal. It doesn't pick the medical similarities. So the next one is, here I want to show you. Regarding this editing part. So for example, here, this is one, this is called Proof Central. Proof Central is, for elsewhere has Proof Central. So once your article is accepted, so they will send it to you for revising. So that is more like a Google Docs editing, but it is a closed group between the authors and the reviewers. So it will give last chance for the authors to change whatever modifications they want to do. It is after acceptance. Maybe we should have discussed this later, but still. So this is called Proof Central or Galley Proof. Something called Galley Proof is just before publication, even the DOI number, digital object identifier number, will be given. But still before online publication and print publication, the author will be given a chance to edit. I think it's getting late. Yeah, I think this is already loaded. It's here. So in this page, you can collaborate with the authors, other authors. This is invite co-author, and you can. These are my co-authors, so I can invite them. And what are all the changes I want to make? Final changes. I can do these changes, and this will be the final one. Beyond that, there won't be any change in the text. Okay, so this is called this galley proof checking before final acceptance. And let me check regarding one other feature. Yes. So for example, here submitted one manuscript to this journal, and it is in revision. So if it is in So here it is in revision. So for revision, the authors will, the reviewers will say something like this. Reviewer A, these are his findings, abstract. These are the changes should be made, and they are not very clear. Introduction, they are not very clear about this. Materials and methods. So are you able to hear?
Screen share
page, sir.
Screen is share it okay? Out. Screen is sharing or not, sir? No,
no, no. No. Screen not is not sharing.
Oh, okay, okay. Wait, I'll try to do again.
Yeah. You have a few more slides, JV?
Yeah, yeah, sir. One or two slides, maybe very less slides, sir. I will go finish. So, here, now it's okay, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, this is how the reviewers will communicate with the author. So how to revise, here they see the line numbers are used. So you have to use the line numbers for discussing with the author. Okay, then we'll proceed with the last few more slides are left. So submitting manuscript, you find the suitable journal. For that, there is something called a journal finder in elsewhere. And even Springer also, they have how to find the journal. So here, for that, if you type your title and the abstract and the keywords, based on that input, the journals will find the relevant journals in which your article will be of interest, so that there are more chances that it will get published in that. So this is called in Springer, and both the things have finding journal option. And I will proceed with this itself. Addressing queries, reviewers will send some queries like that, and we should stick to the deadlines and we should answer them. The common mistakes are don't write case, write as patient, and spell letters 1 to 10. Don't start with sentence with a digit, and use past tense everywhere. No, don't use present tense. Don't use contraction, isn't, doesn't, like that. And follow guidelines for updating tables and format. So these are the journals in which I am a reviewer. So I find these are the common problems with the manuscripts. And finally, the last slide. So introduction is, why did you start at the beginning? And methods, what did you do? Results, what did you find from your study? And discussion, what does it mean with relevance to the existing literature? And finally, so what do you recommend to the reader or the audience? So this is the coming to the conclusion, sir. Thirusar, you can proceed.
JV, can we stop sharing or?
Yeah, yes, sir. I've stopped.
Yeah. I think it's a very marathon session from both of you. I honestly thank you for for giving us the entire details. And so I think we'll open the question straight away. So I think PGs, are they able to, whether they were able to follow or not? This is what they have to understand, actually. So all this Zotero, Mendeley, SkyHub. All these Google spreadsheets will make life easier. And I know, because Ramprasad Sonara, Pujis will not know about it, but to his surprise, all the SkyHub, DOI, I learned from PGs only. Okay, because there were a few PGs who taught me how to, use SkyHub, Zotero, and all these Rampi. Namma edirpaakkaradoda PGs are much faster, and they can learn faster than what we learned. Learned it the hard way. They are very, they are all technologically very in JV. You see, is what we saw Jay Venkatesh and what he is now. He's a reviewer, Somashekar, he's a reviewer, he's an editor, and he can play with Google Sheets, Google Spread, whatever you want, he can do with these things. So I think message to the PGs is, learn all this very easy. It is like, video game la ramari da idu. Zotero, all the SkyHub, you can just play with it, start learning, and then once it becomes relevant to you, I think you can publish a lot of articles. So I think I'll open it for the postgraduates to ask a few questions. Ram Prasad, whomsoever wants to ask, I think we can go ahead.
Jay Vangadesh.
Sir.
What are the journals in which you are a reviewer? I saw AJO in that.
AJO, then US-based journals are Curious. And the other one is Indian journal, sir. Journal of JCDR, Journal of Clinical and Diagnostic Research. And other JOCR also, sir. The Journal of Orthopedic Case Report, this Pune-based journal.
Yes, Dr. Ashok Shyam.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then there is one question.
JV, there are a couple of questions.
Yes, sir.
Can you explain regarding the usage of line numbers? I think somebody has asked that.
Yes, sir. There is something called page layout in the Google Word in the top. So if you go there, if you click line numbers, you can start from the title page. Or if you want to every page to be given a separate number also, it will give. But usually we start from the beginning until the last. So in both for Google Docs, there is no direct line numbers. You have to have a separate add-on to the Google Docs. That is free of cost. We can do that.
So line numbers will not be there in Google Docs.
Google Docs, it's not easily seen. You have to go to settings and change those things.
And there is one question which someone has asked, how to get an ethical clearance for private practitioners, sir. It doesn't mean in your city or in your town, if you have any institute, like for example, in Madurai, we didn't have ethical committee for a very long time. We got it just this year. Earlier, we used to submit the same papers to Arvind Medical Research Institute, where they had an ethical board. So in your city or in your town or nearby, if you have any ethical board, you can submit it to them and get a review clearance and start doing the research. It has nothing like that only in your institute or hospital should also have an ethical clearance, ethical board. It can be done from other institutes as well. Only thing is that board has to accept your paper. That's all.
Any medical college, in medical college is there in each district, and each medical college will have ethical board. You can apply to the medical colleges. I think that will be very much acceptable. Yeah.
Only thing is you have to quote the number, PCR number, that every ethical board will have one number. That number should be quoted when you publish the data.
Somebody has asked regarding this line number again. In the Google, in the Microsoft Word, there is something called page layout. And you have to click the page layout and your line numbers will be automatically added to the existing manuscript. So the use is to discuss with the others with relevant to, you see here, I think my screen is sharing. So this is called page layout. Here you can see margin, orientation, column, page. So here this comes the line number. So if you want to, if there is no line number, if you click this on, your line numbers will be off. If I put none, so the line numbers will disappear. It should disappear. This is how the line number works. Yeah, thank you.
Jay, one more doubt. Actually, Dr. Ramprasad has got some connection problem. What is running title? Is there running title? Is there anything?
Yeah, very good, sir. Running title, now I will share one. So running title is, if your title is usually two lines or three lines, but for every page of the article at the top right side, they want one line to be written. For example, if you're comparing your some TKR using two different implants, they will write comparison of TKR by Genesis and Journey. So, but you have in your main title, you would have written comparison based on so-and-so variables, 2 years results, case series, those things. But in short, within 6 words, they want something to be written in the top. So if you, the journal is 4 pages article, all the 4 pages will have that in the top in, as a header.
Okay. And one more thing, meta-analysis, somebody asked, meta-analysis, does it need ethical clearance? I don't think it needs ethical clearance because it is only analysis of... And all the articles that doesn't need any ethical, because all the articles that you're going to assess have already got ethical clearance.
Yes.
So true. It is only a collection of all the articles. JV, a screen stop on it, I think it'll be easy.
Sorry, sir.
PGs, I think, verda kekkona kelunga, because I know this is a very, something words are very new, you know, so even for all the final year postgraduates and people like me also, a lot of new words are there. So the, I think the future is only going to be, you know, publishing. So you'll be recognized, as Dr. Vetrivel Chetan said, you'll be recognized only with, only if you're going to publish. And especially in the COVID-19 situation, only because a lot of articles were there, we were able to treat. Only the articles, which even if it is a case series or case study, level one evidence, whatever is available, we were able to, you know, manage with, because of all these evidences that were given to us. I think in future, this publishing has to be done. I just took it as a beginning of, you know, just to tell the PGs to, you know, understand there are so many things. But there are so many things. So you just go back and, you know, in the words, collect pani paathita, I think you can do a reference. Is there any other questions?
Sir, one observation that we have found in this COVID instance is that what they are doing, if you are going back to the literature, means you see all major journals, in the last 1 month, there are so many number of journals that has been published. In fact, the other day, Mohit Bhandari was telling that there are journals which has published on the date of submission itself. So many of these journals or articles which are published are just an opinion. So especially for COVID, it's better. He says that you, even in a reputed journals also, sometimes it will become an expert opinion. So only with time, probably we'll get much more stronger evidence, and then we'll be able to follow it. Because now everyone is giving their opinion. Even in fact, I feel that those papers who are coming from either Italy or China, their observations are much stronger, for the reason because they have already experienced the COVID pandemic, and then probably they may be able to give much better information. But opinions are not to be accepted in the initial days, but after some time, probably total complete evidence will come, and then you can utilize that data for your clinical practice.
Yeah. And one more question, sir. JV, is there a simplified guide to select the method of statistical analysis to write a manuscript? So can you make this statistical analysis simple? That's what his question. How to simplify your statistical analysis?
So that's why I'm answering. There are, the type of analysis that has to be used that we should learn. But there are few online tools that will help doing statistical analysis if you know the methodology. For example, if you know, if you're using paired t-test or something, Mann-Whitney-U test, whatever you're using, if you know that this is what you're going to use, entering the variables and doing this easier rather than doing yourself in Excel or SSPS. There are softwares like OpenAPI, like MediCalc and GraphPad. These are the various softwares. Many of them are free. So in that you can enter your data and see the p-value. So that is possible.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Thanks, JV. This in between there's some, I think, technical internet issues. Rampi, one thing, you want to ask something?
Same question. What is one by running?
He has answered. JV, I think you can answer. He wants to know what is the running.
Running title, once again, sir.
Yeah. Sir, if you take some article, in the first page of the article, you will have the title. For example, in the next successive pages, you will not find the title of the article. In that, in the top right corner, if the title is of some two, three lines, only one line will be written as a heading, as a simplified title. So that is called running title, usually 6 words. So that the second page, third page, fourth page will have that title in the top for easy reference for the readers. That is running title.
You mean abstract for the manuscript?
Internet connection.
Okay.
So there is a small, you abbreviate your title. And you abbreviate your title, and the abbreviated title will run in all the other pages of the article. So the first page will have the title, and the other pages will have an abbreviated version of your title.
Yes.
Or a short form of your title. I think that is what is called the running title. So.
And in preparing the manuscript, you mentioned double spacing. What is that? In between the words or in between the lines?
In between the lines, sir. In the word, you can have one, I don't know how much distance, millimeter, but 1.5, 2. These are the ways you can do spacing. So double spacing is easier to read. Actual print will come with less spacing. For sending even thesis writing, most of dissertation has to be printed with the double spacing only.
So we have to mark it as two, the line spacing.
You have to select in the top, there is something.
Line spacing.
Yeah, line spacing is there. So you, if you go select that, you can do double spacing. So that's not a big deal.
I think we are running from an era. JV, I think.
This is running Rakela. Title. In the top.
Okay.
The title is different.
Correct. Okay.
So this is this top edge corner. This is called running title, sir.
புரியுது to postgraduates, I think it has to be introduced to all the postgraduates to learn Google Docs, Google Sheets, Google Spread, everything. I think Google Slides and all. So that in the version, if it is inculcated into the curriculum of the postgraduate, or he has to go and learn it separately if it is not inculcated. I think only then the survival will be there only if you learn all this. I think high time, and already most of the postgraduates are good enough in computer, I know that.
So,
Sir. Hello.
Dr. Suresh Babu.
Suresh Babu,
thank you. Thank you. I was listening to the talk. It's a very good talk. Thank you, Dr. Soma Sagar, sir. And Jay Angresh, very good. Very nicely. Dr. Suresh Babu from ICT.
Thank you, sir.
I learned
many. Leading pediatric orthopedic surgeon.
Yes, not yes. Not a pediatric orthopedician.
எங்களுக்கு முடியாத கேஸ்ல அவரிட்ட அனுப்பி விடுறோம்.
PG in ICH, sir. Sir, with sir. And outside
also. I learned a lot of things from you. Very, very nice. Very good talk. I think, Thiru, nowadays, yes, no, even the students, no, the school students, no, they've started learning. Maybe after yes. a few generations, no.
Yes.
Everybody will know what is Google Sheet. The technology will be from predatory journals.
Yes, yes, so, yes.
What is that predatory journalist? How to avoid?
Yeah, sir.
There are warning journal, don't.
Yes. So that is that is how the indexing has come into place. Scopus, PubMed, and of course these are the recognized indexing indexing providers. If the journal is indexed in those things, then you can do. But then at the same time, there are journals in early phase. Early phase journals, they will not get indexed quickly. PubMed and all want 5 years existence of a journal to get PubMed indexing. So, usually choose journals from organizations. For example, IOA, Indian Orthopedic Association, their parent journal. Tamil Nadu Orthopedic Association, their parent journal. So, like that, if there is some existing organization and if you are submitting to that journal, that is good. Okay. On the other hand, there are journals that is wide for agriculture, engineering, social sciences, for arts and science, that they are business-minded people and they do publishing and not up to the standards. So preferably avoid those kind of non-indexed journals for your publication. So this is what predatory means.
There are many journals for MCA purpose. Eh? Yes, there are many journals available. I think Thirunarayan know about all these things.
Not yes.
To answer your question, now, hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Lala, see, now it has become the predatory journals. Questions will not come after this because MCA mandate has changed. The indexing agencies have also been changed. Okay, so the now indexing agencies are going to be more strict and they're going to scrutinize your indexing. You know, if you go for indexing, the scrutinization will be very, very, very harsh. And so something like DOAJ, Scopus, PubMed, I think they'll restrict the number of articles. And even you can be third author or fourth author, but the journal has to be, you know, of good quality. So that is what the MCA is looking up. So even if it is but my advice to the postgraduates would be to whatever, don't go and try to first publish a very, 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 you know, in a big journal. That will be a miserable failure and you'll not go back. Myself and Ram Prasad learned that because initially we sent to JBJS, IJO, and CORR and all, and it became a miserable failure. And for two, 3 years, then because of these failures, after that we lost interest in publishing. And then only we took up the smaller journals and then started publishing, you know, articles of even lesser quality. And then we published in smaller articles. So the one acceptance of one article will give you the drive. So
you can learn, I think.
Yeah, from that one article will give you the drive to go and publish in other, you know, better journals. So my advice will be to, you know, start publishing, even if it is of a lower quality journal, don't worry about it. I think you can go and do that and then go in for higher level like IJO, JBJS, where the you can learn how to, you know, you develop your skill of writing the article. And even within one or two reviews, your articles would be accepted.
Is it necessary to pay? I think someone has already asked.
Yes. Because most of the articles will charge you. Okay. Because and there is a something like a fast track. And, you know, you want to do a fast track submission, then it would be double the cost. So it would be 2,000 to 4,000. So most of the articles will charge you. Because they have to run an article. And, you know, the of course, with this money, is not much for them. But still, they have to run an article and they'll definitely charge you most of the articles. Don't worry about the charge. 3,000 or 4,000 is not big money. Even otherwise, you can know two or three or four authors are there, then you can share the amount. You can submit in one journal and he can submit in another journal. So don't worry about the money and all. It will be there. Definitely, it is charged. Few journals, no, most of the journals will charge. The JBJS journal is exorbitant. I think it's 40,000 to 50,000 rupees when you convert into Indian money, JBJS. CORR also is very expensive. So, and I think few only are not charging. In index injury also they charge. The injury article also they charge. So most of the articles will charge.
Sir, one correction, sir. Can I tell, sir?
Yes.
Jay Venkatesh. Sir, actually, it is not that we should not publish, you should not try to publish in this high impact journals, but preferably we should be ready to accept the refusal, because once it has been taken by the editorial board for review, then the reviewers will tell their comments. So based on the comments, you can improve your manuscript and you can send to the next in line journal.
Yes. So I think this point I learned from Dr. Deenadayalan sir from Ganga Hospital. He was a TNOI president. He always says, so once you write an article, you write it to the standard of JBJS. At least you think you've written to the standard of JBJS. You send it to JBJS. They will give all the comments. Okay, then your article will be rejected. Then you send it to injury. Okay, then they will reject it.
That's a good
then
idea.
They'll give you all the comments. So take all the comments. Yeah. Then you go to injury. Okay, then you submit it in injury. Even if it is not submitted in injury, then you go to the next level. So you keep in mind JBJS, but at least finally you end up in IJO or, you know, something of that standard. So I do take your point.
You should not get demotivated.
Yeah, don't get demotivated. You just use this as a, you know, tool to
improve,
reduce it. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So any questions?
Also, one more thing, sir. Usually when they write their thesis, no, they finish off all their discussion, materials and methods, everything, and then they just keep it aside, and in the final year, they'll try to write the results and everything. What I feel that if you want to publish, no, you take all the data from it, analyze the data and find out what is the exact result or the end game that you got it. Based on it, you try to do the discussion. Then it will be more encouraging, more fruitful, and then you'll come to a logical conclusion. Usually PGs during thesis, what they do is first and second year itself, they will finish off the discussion part and then those initial anatomy, physiological parts and all, and then they'll try to insert what is being already discussed in their results, rather than going back from discussion to the materials and methods or the results. Start from the results and then try to do the discussion based on it.
Yeah, that is a part of a reversed kind of analysis. And there was one more question, Chodan. I don't think you have to pay any money for submitting your thesis, for some you are submitting to article. It's only after the acceptance that you have to pay the money. You don't worry about it.
There are few journals, they start, even Malaysian Orthopedic Journal is PubMed indexed. They charge $75 for submitting itself.
No, myself and Ram Prasad, we have already submitted one article in Malaysian Orthopedic Journal. We also submitted two more. I don't know the present one, but you know, one more article we submitted. Actually, we submitted three articles from Raipeta. One got accepted, one got rejected, and one is still pending. But they have not charged any money.
Listen, I have seen recently an article. I've never seen that. It was new for me. Usually, they won't charge unless it is getting accepted. But the first time I saw the 75
years. Now they changed because this was 2 years back. Malaysian Orthopedic Journal rejected one of our articles. Then we withdrew it and we submitted some other journal. So the message to the postgraduates here is, you know, don't worry about too much about these things. With your career, you have to learn to publish. You have to learn to write articles. I think that is the most important thing. Once you read one article, one subject, It is not about actually namu vandu nammalude name irukano, that is one part, but you will start understanding the subject much better. You go take just one distal tibial fractures eduthu or 10 article padichina, then your understanding of the distal tibial article is completely different. Next, when you go see a distal tibial article, mean fracture, then your way you will deal with it is completely different. So you want, so it's something like even a proximal femur fractures, that's how they learn. See, they had a classification for your lateral wall. That's what Dr. Somashekar said. Even I did not know that also there was a classification for lateral wall till I went and learned from some other article. So once you learn your article, once you start doing research, then you'll understand the subject, and you know, you'll start liking the subject. Then you'll know that so much things were there which you did not know when you operated. So even a hemiarthroplasty, even a totally preplacement, there are so many articles to go and read. Then you try to I don't know about the others, Somashekar and JV feel, because once you go and do research, then you will understand the subject. You know, your orientation to the subject is completely different.
Yes.
Because unless you start reading and then analyzing your own cases, you will be motivated to see much more better. In fact, that is how we are going to do much more number of papers and publications and research. And then you'll be more interested in doing it. Otherwise, it will be a monotonous. Okay, IT fracture, do DHS or PFLN and come back. Rather than that, you see what's happening and then how your results have changed. And then based on it, you can do something new about it.
Yeah, and that gives you a lot of innovation also. So you can alter your, you know, whatever thing, you can innovate and do a lot of things. So with this background and this technology which is there to help you, like Zotero, you know, this Mendeley and so many other things, please make use of it, because I think that it's like, you know, playing again. That's what I'm telling you. It is, you know, you'll really love it. So that's what I want to tell the message. And thesis also, make sure that you select your thesis very early, even complete your thesis also a little early, and then start analyzing. Don't submit it. Start analyzing your thesis again and again, so that it will be easy, and try to convert your thesis into an article. And as you do your post-graduation, try to, before you complete your post-graduation, make sure that you write at least one or two articles. So at least you be a part of one or two articles, help your assistants, and also, Dr. Prabhakar, I think he wants to ask some question. Prabha, please. Prabha is silent, I don't know. Cholan, Prabha is silent. So Dr. Prabhakar also is one of the assistants in Raipet Hospital. So he's very much interested in writing articles. And we've also selected one of his articles in JOJS, which is part of the TNOA. And JV, the TNOA started the JOJS. I think you are aware of that.
Yes, sir. I
think I'll have to discuss with you to go for indexing, because it's the process of indexing. I think we can discuss it separately. I think you need to help me regarding the indexing of JOJS.
Sure.
I'm on the track, but definitely we'll need your help. If there are no more questions, I think we will complete the either. So I know,
sir,
it is
concluding part, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Sorry, ma'am.
Sir, regarding these things, the free online courses are from Coursera. I did not mention that they have a lot of courses regarding research methodology and even Google.
What is that?
Coursera. Coursera. Coursera.
Okay.
So that gives a lot of free data. And for every department, they can have an email ID and password shared by others. And in that department email ID, in the Google Drive, all the presentations, PowerPoint presentations that are made can be uploaded.
Okay.
So that over the years, that will have a data of the presentations. Even students, final year students' presentation also can be added in that one.
So what is the maximum content or maximum capacity is Google?
15 GB, then, sir, for all the 15 GB. So our, if you don't have images, so much data can be saved. Mm. Otherwise, we can do a second email ID one. There's no problem.
No, we prefer to keep it in hard disk drive.
Yes, sir. The importance is the slides sharing part, sir, so that pen drive will be lost, hard drive crash, those problems won't be there.
Okay, I think we have to subscribe for these Google Drives also. I think that is also another message. So I think we can keep a subscription for Google Drive also, so that we can store more, data.
Yeah.
And
every Google email ID is eligible to have 15 GB, sir. So you just create free email ID, that's all. You can have all the department related, even duty roster you can make in the Google spreadsheet, and everybody will log in and see with the same username and password.
I think future also, K-Sheets also, I think they're going to ask you to write in Google Sheets. Once you go to, or Google Sheet or some form of Google Sheet.
Yes,
once you go to a corporate, most of the postgraduates are going to go and work in corporate hospitals.
Yes, electronic
medical. If they're going to know about Google Sheets, the PowerPoint and also other safety things, definitely the hospital will be very glad to, accept them as a consultant.
Yes.
So it'll be easy for them to start rather than going there and learning. Soma Shekhandal is in corporate hospital, they will know. Because yes. he's got extra knowledge in computer, how.
One more thing, last but not the least, National Board conducts a 3-day course for all the entry level postgraduates in that first year itself.
It's compulsory for MS postgraduates also.
Okay, then if they can understand that.
It is compulsory now for MS postgraduates to do this research methodology. But these kind of technical advancements may not be there. Yeah. So I also have to thank the postgraduates, for having be very patiently sitting for, completely different subject. Or hip or spine or I can expect them to, come and join the program. But this is a completely out of box topic. So I thought just to kindle a little bit of the interest in them to go and write an article or at least help the assistant or chief to go and write an article and help them. But it will be very easy, my work if the postgraduate does, because most of the postgraduates have helped me. So then definitely it will be easy for me also. And also their name also will be included in the article, which is a big thing which can they carry before they go as a postgraduate. So I immensely thank the postgraduates and all the people who joined the program today. And definitely Dr. Soma Shekhar and J.M. Venkatesh for giving us so much, information, which I think I will also, they wanted the email IDs of the speakers also. I think it has been shared already. And so really, thank you so much, JV. I think we'll continue our, this relationship with at least in the future meetings. And definitely when in need, we'll definitely, we'll rope you back into our Zoom meeting in future.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. In fact, we learned more than being here than any other way around.
That's what you told, to learn and to teach. I think that is the maximum knowledge. So you've learned and also you've spoken and you've taught.
Meeting lab. Matter solving.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Sorry. Okay.
Solla Prabha.
Sir, still a doubt, sir. Just some more doubts. How to clear the grammatical errors? Most of the time when I write a article, na, is there any software to avoid the grammatical errors?
Yes, sir.
So, common, I encountered this. I try to write, but yes, grammatical errors.
Now I think you can see my screen, sir.
Yes.
Okay, sorry. Actually, I don't have this Grammarly embedded in this, but usually here next to Acrobat, there will be Grammarly. Grammarly, the YouTube, you will be seeing many advertisement Grammarly that you can add. And
okay.
Microsoft Word itself has this spelling and grammar check. So here, all these red lines indicate some spelling mistake, and this one blue lines, green lines say grammatical errors. Google Docs has an inbuilt grammar checker that is equivalent to Grammarly. So whatever mistakes you make, that will automatically ask for correction. If you say okay, that will correct. So that is in that way. We need not to spend time in. Giving to somebody for a grammar check alone.
Okay. Then one more thing, which adds weightage to the research? Suppose these are the parameters to be needed. Is that the t-test, PAD t-test is relevant for all studies or just like that?
Listen, mainly the study question, the authors, journals see the innovation and the new idea or new question, that is what the journals want, and if the result which you are telling is substantiated by good statistical methods, it is okay. Cannot say this particular test is good, but in general, even if the topic is a known topic for everybody, the question should be something of the latest trend. And
statistical ponalum, it will not carry a lot of weightage, because the study gives more importance than the statistics, but it has to be statistically significant. The statistical significance, you have to work out with the biostatistician, as already JV has told. Just sit with the statistician and number of cases. How do you randomize? How do you select the number of cases for your study? What is the total number of population that you're going to take? Out of which, what will be your relevant cases? So, other mutton, you have to sit with the statistician and analyze each of your result with the statistician and do that. whatever yes, is sir. More important that you publish. You romba statistical la ponanalo nama it becomes difficult to
very
follow
very difficult
for yeah
so one more thing sir the reference la Vancouver pattern what is that Vancouver
adu Vancouver undu onnu kedaiyadhu style of your idu avladha fonts avladha
adha sir adile Vancouver na in that the references will be added in the sequence in which they appear in the text idhe vandu APS style na alphabetical order la reference irukum so okay, Vancouver na ipo introduction la first second reference irukum materials method la third fourth
discussion la podralla adu
and the 1 2 3 4 in the order it appears அதுக்கப்புறம் சின்ன மைனர் டீடைல்ஸ் தட் யூ கேன் சி எத்தனை பேர் ஆத்தர் பேர் எழுதணும் எப்படி நீங்க கன்சைஸ் பண்ணி எழுதணும் தோஸ் திங்ஸ் ஆர் தட்
ஓகே ஓகே சார் வாட் வி ஆர் டுயிங் ஆல் ஆர் இல்ல டிஸ்கிரிப்டிவ் ஸ்டடிஸ் தானே சார் வி ஆர் நாட் டுயிங் ரேண்டமைஸ்ட் கண்ட்ரோல் ஸ்டடி இஸ் தேர் எனி ஆர்டிகல் டு தட் சப்போர்ட் ரேண்டமைஸ்ட் கண்ட்ரோல் ஸ்டடி நாட் தோ இல்ல எல்லாமே டிஸ்கிரிப்டிவா தான் பண்ற மாதிரி இருக்கு
ஆமா அதாவது எதர் இட் இஸ் a கேஸ் சீரிஸ் ஜெனரலி போஸ்ட் கிராஜுவேட் லெவல் டு மை நாலேஜ் இட் இஸ் லைக் கேஸ் சீரிஸ் நம்பர் ஆஃப் கேसेस அப்சர்வேஷன் ஸ்டடி
அப்சர்வேஷன் ஸ்டடிஸ்
அப்சர்வேஷன் அண்ட் ஆஃப் கோர்ஸ் கேஸ் கண்ட்ரோல் இஃப் தே ஆர் டு ஹேவிங் டு டிஃபரண்ட் னா கேஸ் கண்ட்ரோல் ஸ்டடி அஸ் ரேண்டமைஸ்னா ப்ராஸ்பெக்டிவா இருந்து யூ ஹேவ் டு டிஃபரண்ட் அஸ் வி டிஸ்கஸ்ட் अर्लियर டு குரூப்ஸ் ஷட் பீ ரேண்டமைஸ்ட் அண்ட் யூ ஹேவ் டு கெட் அப்ரூவல் பிரையர் அண்ட் ரெட்ரோஸ்பெக்டிவ் cannot be randomized
Okay. Okay. After your talk, what I understood is either I have to learn Google Docs and Google Sheets from the postgraduates, or thaniya vandu othra koopta yara solli kudukka vekkano. And we are planning to even conduct the exam Google Sheet Google Docs lo or exam conduct panni for all postgraduates, make it mandatory for them informal exam.
Adha sir, that is what this course ra and other they have if they proceed.